So it's a great pleasure to be speaking to you about what we've been doing at Bath. So without further ado, I'll get on. So who am I? I'm Richard Prowse. I'm head of content at the University of Bath. I've actually replaced Ross Ferguson and along with the technical architect, Phil Wilson, to co-manage the digital team at Bath now. So for the last 2.5 years, we've been working on a project to transition Bath.ac.uk, and you kind of lived through the highs, the lows with us, and I'm back today to talk a little bit more about that and what we've been doing for the last 12 months and actually some lessons learned. This is particularly focused on content, which is my area, and I just kind of want to talk about what's gone well and what hasn't gone so well and what we've actually learned through kind of using Agile's approach to content development and delivery. So for those who haven't been to IWMW before, and I think there are, who hasn't been to IWMW before? Hello, newbies. Welcome. I thought it'd be useful to touch on some of the goals, the principles, and intended outcomes of the project. Otherwise, you'll be like, whoa, what's going on? So I thought long and hard about this, about what their actual goal was, because we know what we're trying to achieve, but actually trying to write it down, it's quite difficult because the project's broken into different parts. So I'm going to focus, like I said, particularly on the content and design element. So for the overarching goal was to deliver a single unified presence for by transitioning bath.ac.uk to new publishing platform and website. But this has only been part of the goal. So the other part really has been, and we won't touch on it here, but if anybody wants to speak to me afterwards, has been to design and develop a new CMS, what we call a publishing platform. And the devs have been doing an amazing job for the last 2 years. They've built a CMS from scratch. Tom's here today. There he is. Hello, Tom, are you awake? Yeah, good. But I thought it was important I kind of touch on that because they have been doing such amazing work and we wouldn't be where we are today without their support. And that's how we work as a team. We're a collaborative team, devs and content people working side by side in effectively marketing communications function at the University of Bath. So for those who don't know, the kind of goal has been underpinned by our delivery principles. These were put in place by Ross Ferguson, and effectively they are put user needs first, make decisions based on data, release iteratively and often, keep things simple and consistent, provide ongoing support, and work in the open. And this not only underpins our work, but also underpins our work with others. So when we work with external departments to us, these are effectively the rules we follow. We say, this is the way we're going to work with you. Some of you may recognize it, these kind of goals, either from previous IWMWs, but also they have their heritage back. Our genetics are from GDS. Ross Ferguson started at GDS. So there's where they come from. So the outcomes of the project, the intended outcomes are that the website should be easy to navigate and find information. Content should be relevant and useful. It's an important one, guys. Let's make it relevant and useful. It's quicker for visitors to complete tasks. But also on the other side, not only thinking about our actual users, our customers, we've also been thinking heavily about how we build a publishing community. So about building a publishing community, so one that's a kind of, it's not just us. We can't deliver the website on our own. And without the people we work with every day in the departments, we wouldn't be able to do what we've been doing. And their goodwill, their time, their support, their honesty and openness has been essential to what we've been doing. But also, we wanted to build some shared standards and structure, as there was no standards and structure, and deliver sustainability. Because one of the biggest challenges we have from a content perspective is we have 500,000 content items currently split across two CMSs. And with the number of active authors, it far extends the university's ability to maintain it. So those have been a really important key kind of outcomes what we want from this project. So those who've heard me last year, I talked about the kind of our approach, how we are actually doing this. This is a slightly different approach, but I'm going to kind of just touch on that stuff before we go any further. So like a growing number of universities, we've adopted an agile approach, and I'm putting here a mindset to content design and development, and that's been key for us. So what does that kind of mean on the ground? And I don't have very long, so I'm going to kind of go through it quickly. What that means from a content perspective, we apply agile techniques to the planning, creation, and governance of digital content. And that's what we've been doing over the last, well, 2 years, but really in the last 12 months, quite heavily working across delivery of content, improving governance. It's been a really, really, well, what's the best way to put it? It's been an interesting ride, it's been a challenging one, and it's been also been an exciting one. So if anybody's interested, there's a talk on the Gather Content website about this. It wasn't recorded from previous year, so okay, if anybody's interested in finding out actually the processes we're using, please go there because it's got the actual presentation. Okay, so what is Agile? It means lots. It was interesting. I had a conversation at the Maritime Museum, and I think it was right. Agile means different things to different people, and people implement it in different ways. We're not a purist in any way. We have our own brand of Agile, and we use it in the way that works best for us. And I think that's the best way to approach it, because it needs to flex and fit for your organization. So for those who don't know, basically Agile is a product-led approach to development, where discovery, design, testing are ongoing throughout the delivery process. And for us, it's broken down into two-week sprints, where we ship at the end. Just for your understanding, when I say ship, I mean publishing. Well, it doesn't always lead to an outcome like that. It could be we complete a piece of discovery effectively. We tend to flex that definition quite heavily, depending upon our need. But coming back to where I was and really where this presentation will kind of lead on to is Agile is more than a set of tools and processes. It's also a mindset. And it's a way of thinking, and it's really quite hard to do on a day-to-day basis when all the other pressures of university life are around you, business as usual, crises that just rear their ugly heads. And I think the single most important thing is thinking about how you think about your approach to things and the way that you deal with basically delivery and also the day-to-day issues you approach. Having that agile mindset is key. If you don't, then having processes and tools won't really mean anything. So what is an agile mindset? Well, this is my definition. Somebody with an agile mindset stays focused on what's important. They learn through doing, they listen to others, and that's really key. It's not about you knowing best as an individual. It's about listening to others in your team and basically coming to a conclusion on the best way forward. This is a favorite one of us. Keeping themselves and others honest. And I think that's really true. I think we hold retrospectives, and that's a way of helping us keep ourselves honest. There's some of the, when I first did a retrospective, it was quite brutal, but I've learned to kind of actually enjoy them because of where it's an opportunity for the team to be very, very honest and open about what worked well and what didn't. And sometimes that's uncomfortable, especially as a head of content, because the team's saying, oh, this didn't work well, Rich. And I'm like, but actually for me, it's really important because it's an opportunity for you to hear what you can make better and help the team deliver in future more easily, removing those blockers. And actually, the other thing is seeing failure as an opportunity. That's really important. I'm going to be honest, not everything we've done has gone as well as we wanted it to go. But the point is, we didn't just leave that. We actually learned from it, and we changed our approach. And that's key. Because if we didn't try it, then we wouldn't have known what worked and what didn't, and then we wouldn't be improving it. So I think that's an important lesson as well. So it's somebody who has those, thinks in that way. So I guess the question is, what did we do well? Okay. So key to our successes is an agile mindset, following BAS playbook. So the tangible outputs really have been so far, and it kind of, when I was kind of writing it, I thought, wow, this doesn't sound very much, but it's huge. It's taken us so much time to get to this point, even though we've been kind of designing, developing, testing, shipping. So far we've restructured from ground up, rewritten up to basically six departments and working with their lead publishers. And we've shipped four of those. We're currently focusing on professional services, and I'll come on to the reasons why in a minute. And that's seen roughly an overall reduction in the size of sections by about 70%, which is huge because one of the issues we have is sustainability. How do we sustain the content we have on a day-to-day basis? We can't migrate or transition 500,000 items, and actually the majority of those are probably not needed. They're just kind of the process where you put something in a drawer and shut it and forget about it, and then a few years later you come back and go, oh, that's good, isn't it? So it's been a massive process for us to get this to this point. So this is the new bath.ac.uk. I've specifically chosen actually something Miao talked about yesterday worldwide, and also the International Relations Office. These were some of the first sections on the new website to go live, and they have very, very different user needs. This one is really about providing specialist collection pages for people interested in a particular area of the university's activity focused on countries. This is worldwide for South Africa, which we ran and is currently running if you want to go and see. Whereas we have the International Relations Office, which is really more targeted at people who understand our organization, are trying to find out and make contact with people within the International Relations Office. Generally, I'd say that's targeted more at our internal audiences. Worldwide is more our external audiences. So we're focusing on those needs. So people who need specialist information regarding our activities in a particular country, for example, and then people who really want to understand team structures and contact individuals about a particular area, for example, international mobility. And I'm really, really proud of those. So next one, actually, I'll take you through that. So I'm gonna not use this particular example, I'm gonna use a slightly different example. But one of the other tasks was to help visitors complete tasks quicker. And the thing is, we're only very, very newly into this. So I would have liked to share some data with you today, but as you know, Google aggregates data, and we're not further enough in to provide any real meaningful comparisons. What we have found, however, when we do begin to look at the data and compare with previous pages, and the problem is they're not like-for-like pages anymore. The pages, the kind of traffic flow, the time on pages where we think it should be for the what we call content types, the different templates, the journeys look like they're working. This is actually a guide to accommodation in the quads. It's not that exciting in terms of content-wise, it's not. But what it is our first attempt, our first iteration at a guide. And what we've been doing specifically is improving what I like to call the kind of micro journeys that exist in the website. So we have overarching kind of user journeys, which we've been working hard to define. And then within that, we've been working out how people complete particular tasks. Now, before, student accommodation was a behemoth. It was one of the most difficult sections on our website to update because basically we had lots of duplication. It was our CMS allowed us to siblings. There was a version in postgraduate. There was a version in undergraduate. We followed our digital principles, simple and consistent. We have one version, regardless of who you are, for undergraduate and postgraduate, and we've simplified the process. So we have content types dealing with particular user needs. So this is effectively, I want to kind of understand what student accommodation you have on offer so I can make the correct choice. This is weird. There it is. Okay, so basically, we've effectively gone through, it's a very long page. I think we need to work on that. But basically, we've created these journeys. So first step is find out if you're eligible. This is long, this needs work. But this is simple, this has been simplified. It got a little bit complicated because Bath has particularly unique characteristics when it comes to student accommodation. Bath is a very, very small city. So accommodating the number of students we have on a day-to-day basis means occasionally we have to take in private providers to provide our accommodation. So we've had to introduce another section. And effectively, then you go to apply, and then we have our service start. But before, that journey was not present. You couldn't really understand how to go through the process of looking at accommodation, finding out if you were eligible, and then going into the process of applying. What we did notice on the day was, I did some tracking on this, was that people were flowing into the website because effectively on the day registration opens, they're sent to the top level of student accommodation, then they make their way through. And the majority of people got to this page very, very easily. And in fact, we saw a process of people resetting their passwords, which before had been a massive issue for them. So like I said, anecdotally, from the kind of initial data, it appears to be working. From feedback we've had, kind of people coming up to us and saying, hey, that's working really, really well. That's great, because nobody ever normally does that for us. They actually came up and said, this is working well. So what should we have done better? Well, Agile helps focus helps you to focus on the things that matter most. It helps organizations to meet user need, prioritize delivery, and help people collaborate. And overall, the project so far has been an amazing success. But this is a presentation is also a way of keeping myself honest, because as I was going through this, I had to say, well, actually, what didn't go according to plan, or what could we have done better? So the funny thing is that actually what we could have done better sometimes was keep focused on our own playbook. During the heat of delivery and the need to ship and deliver, sometimes we lost focus. And actually, we found, and the kind of conclusion we've come to is, we're at our best as a team and we're best as a university when we focus on our delivery principles. When we lose sight of those, we start to make poor choices about things, not do things as much as in the way we should be doing them. So what do I mean by that? So put your needs first and make decisions on data. So this is the first iteration of our person profile content type. And this is a great example of listening to others. So I'm a great believer in that that people kind of closest to this kind of stuff sometimes actually really do have good insight into actually what they need, what the need is for this thing. So there were some questions really about what the person profile was for. Who is it for? Who is the audience? And we only have a very, very limited data set for this. We made some informed guesses, and we think it's for academic staff and for potentially PhD research students. And we've got no other data beyond that from the analytics and the kind of search terms that we see. And early on, I think there were some problems with the original implementation of person profile. It wasn't really doing what it should do. It wasn't focusing on research. And that's actually, if we agree that is what the it is for, then the main audience for that is academics and our research students. Because we were focused on shipping and we wanted to get this stuff out the door, we dropped the ball a little bit. We didn't really go back and find really any detail. We didn't go and speak to users as much as we should have done. We didn't do as much user research as we should have done. And we made a bad choice. But we learned from that. We learned from failing to. And actually, we also took it as an opportunity to improve it. So in the last few months, we've been working with, I think we've worked now with Bristol, the University of Bristol. We've sent it out to testing. We wanted our other GW4 partners to work with us. Unfortunately, they were busy, and they tried to lend help, but it's like herding cats sometimes. So thank you for your help. And we've also gone internally. We've spoken to internal academics. We've done proper user research on this. And from there, we've iterated on this content type. And now we've got to a point where we believe, because we haven't been able to test this in live yet, that we have a person profile that will work for our users. And I think also what I want to say about this is the funny thing was with our stakeholders, they were actually also weirdly following our digital principles. They were saying, hey, there's something wrong with this. They were trying to keep us honest too. They were trying to say, hey, we think this needs to be something different. We don't think it's meeting user needs properly. So release iteratively and often. Stats. So basically, this is performance data from the CMS. We didn't actually have this information before, so this is amazing. We didn't know what was in the CMS. We didn't know when it was being published, and we didn't know how it's broken down. So for those who were here last year, we kind of went and audited 500,000 assets, and my team nearly killed me. But they all enjoyed it. So we had a problem during kind of the process of testing the person profile content type. That meant that the academic schools wanted to get that right, and I think that was the right for them to do that before we could push the academic content, the kind of school content live. So basically, the velocity we were traveling through the project, which was at points, there were certain points in the initial parts of the project where there were 30 content items being transitioned a day, and they weren't just being copied and pasted, they were literally being rewritten and pair-written. And there were probably 10 to 12 people on this. We effectively came to a sudden stop, which caused some problems. And so therefore, we've had to think about how we move forward in terms of our planning and how we bring those back online. So we have a lot of content, actually. We've transitioned nearly 1,300 content items so far. We've got about 300 live, so we've got a backlog. and now we have a process for getting that live. But we also learned something else from that process. We've got a range of websites that we're working on with different stakeholders. They're going to kill me because I said website. Sections. Our problem was, when we initially did the audit, we were thinking in organizational structures because it was the only way we could organize this information in a way that made sense to anybody. We're dealing with 300 top-level sections, multiple, like, folders inside folders. Lots of whale fins. One of my favorite things we discovered was whale fins. 10,000 pictures of left and right whale fins. It was brilliant. Great research project. Fortunately, the academic had gone and nobody knew what really to do with them. It was one of the many interesting things we discovered on our way. So basically, we were thinking in organizational structures. And that's fine in some respects for certain transitions like international relations, because they are kind of contained. They're a service, they're delivering services to the university. But for other types of content, which are kind of more audience focused and delivered by multiple services, the problem has been it's kind of cut straight down the middle. So how do we deal with that problem? How do we make a end-to-end user journey make sense? So we've learned now, effectively, through the process of doing this, that sometimes transitioning in as an org is not a sensible approach. For example, we're doing induction at the moment, which is something we do every year, but we're working in transition, bringing all those people together. And again, also for large sites, for example, a computing services site, which can't be, we don't do all of the transition. What we do is, for those who don't know, is we work for 2 weeks with the team, get them up to speed, and then hand it over to them to complete the process of transition. We want to be able to ship something at the end. So kind of going, oh, we're just going to take networking and then transition that. It's not really very, there's not very much value in doing that unless you're really, really interested in networking, which, yes, there are some people, but the greatest benefit, we're looking for the greatest benefit in transition. So what we try to do now is, when we even approach large sites, we look at, is there a clear end-to-end user journey we can deliver? And in this case, computing services, we actually focus on induction. So transitioning all the items that a student needs to, effectively all the tasks that a student maybe need to complete or know about when they first arrive at the university, and we can ship that. And that was actually what helped my thinking was, talking to the university, a business school in Wisconsin, a guy called Robert Merrill. He's doing some great work, and he'll probably hate me for saying this, but he probably would love to talk to you guys, if any of you are working on Agile, because he's doing some amazing stuff out there. And they've been doing a very similar approach, trying to cut up their transition of their content in much more meaningful ways. Yeah. So ultimately, this is something we could have done better. But it actually, that pause in transition gave us time to think, and we learned again. So we learned through doing, and we rethought the transition process. So that's another thing that we've learned. So coming actually, as we've come back to reflect on these, like I said, our playbook has been really, really important. And actually, it's been the answer to a lot of our problems. It's just sometimes we've lost focus. And then if I keep things simple and consistent, yeah. Back to this one. When we first transitioned bits of student accommodation, for example, it was literally like wading through mud. You know, you're like, oh, look, oh, a random piece of information. Oh, look, this bit of information relates to this bit of information. And when we first did that, the majority of the transition went smoothly. But when it actually came to the accommodation pages themselves, and we realized there were some real issues with them. We'd realized that we'd written and implemented things in slightly different ways, because obviously we have multiple people working on the same different guides, but effectively a lot of the accommodation has similar features. So what happened was we not only had potentially multiple user needs in a single page, we also had often slightly different implementations of what's in the room, which was always very interesting. Really detailed, like really detailed. You're like, wow, they've got that as well. Do I need to know that? So what we learned from that was one user need per content item. And that's the rule we've been following. So it actually is a really good rule, because when you approach a page, you're like, oh, this appears to be a mixed need. And actually, it's not really clear what need it fulfills. And so we've gone back and we've said, right, where we've seen pages we've transitioned, which are not exactly right, we've gone, what is the user need? Let's make sure it's correct. Make sure that the page is fulfilling that user need. And if there's something else in it, break it out or question whether it's needed or not. So that's worked pretty well for us. So agile isn't a cure-all. And I don't want anybody to think that when I've been speaking in the past, I said, hey, this is a panacea. This is not going to solve all your problems, guys. I want it to. I want to wake up in the morning and there'd be sunshine in my room and birds not making terrible noises. But it isn't. What it doesn't do is solve some of the structural issues that may exist within your institutions. We have structural issues. For example, we still have issues where we want to carry out transitions, but the university just doesn't have any dedicated post holder to help us do that. And the problem is, if we want to build sustainability into this process, we have to have somebody to look after it. So I'm currently working with the Director of Marketing Communications to begin to address those issues, because we can't transition something if nobody's going to look after it. It's just going to go back to where it was. It's going to go out of date. And that presents an institutional risk, particularly, obviously, things with the Consumer Markets Authority, material information, is this correct, up to date? So don't do transition if you don't have somebody to look after it afterwards. That sounds like a really, really easy thing to remember. Sometimes it can get lost. It's like, why won't you transition the website? It's like, because we really need somebody to support it afterwards. So, lessons learned. Well, I'd actually say what we've learned is that an agile approach to content and BAS playbook do work. And the message of a transition is an enormously positive one. You know, what really gets me up in the morning is that I'm helping students. I didn't get into my job to come to work every day and just put content and help develop content. I actually came to work in universities because I want to make a real difference to people's lives, and I do every single day. I help, and it sounds silly, but I help people make choices about courses because I help design better course content. We help people choose the right accommodation so they're happy where they are. And that makes me feel good. So I have to keep that in focus. But I want to say, we're building products, not projects. And we've moved away from trying to use that term, because otherwise we end up doing lots of little projects that really don't amount to very much other than we fulfilled that immediate need. But what we haven't done is build a sustainable model in which the university can deliver its digital content. We can flex, we've learned to flex our approach based on user need. What I mean by that really is we've thought more, we're learning to keep ourselves focused and continually ask what the user need is here. What are we trying to achieve as a result of doing this? We have a scalable way of working. In the past, it was really, really difficult for us to scale because we'd have to bring people on board. We didn't have a real way of bringing kind of external editors on board with us and then working alongside us. So we now have a scalable way of working. We've trained them, we work alongside them, we practice in this way. We've helped to develop external people skills, so the people we work with, and we have some amazing digital editors we're now working with who just impress me every single day when I come into contact with them. They've taken it and they've run with it, and I am bow down to them because they've come so far. And we've helped break down siloed working practices. Anybody later on asked me about the washing up bottles. It was in our kitchen. It's a brilliant example of siloed thinking in our organization. And we've also begun to produce self-facilitating teams. So we can actually trust teams to look after the websites and get on. Not because we didn't trust them before, but they were just left on their own and didn't really have very much support. I can now trust people to kind of deliver the content that Bath needs to make a difference. So coming back to the very beginning, really, for me, and this is a phrase which Ross used to say to me, and it kind of echoes in my head occasionally. What would I tell my past self about Agile? Well, I said, try it, you'll thank your future self. And actually, that's my journey. I've come from somebody who didn't necessarily wasn't familiar with this area, who was initially very skeptical about how we could even make this work for content, to somebody who genuinely believes that this is something we can do. And ultimately, this isn't about a GDS style playbook for us. It's about we've developed our own way of working, a way of Agile that works for us, and we're hoping to develop that across the University of Bath. So yeah, that's it. Thank you. Any questions?
Hi, I'm Sarah from the University of Kent.
Hello, Sarah.
I just wondered if you've got a specific example of one of the ways you've found to break down those silos.
Actually, one of the most effective ways we've found is actually bringing the team who are working with us into our own office. Because actually, it's almost actually to do with just people, not knowing other people, not trusting them, and actually just not having a day-to-day contact with them. So when we do transition, we actually bring them in, and we make an active attempt to make them part of our kind of wider team. So, you know, they're part of our team rituals. And actually, I think that's been one of the most effective ways. So it's just people. People are people, and people like people. When they get to know each other, they begin to appreciate each other. And then the other stuff is we just try and make sure they're involved in things, so they have regular contact from us. For example, we put out a new community newsletter. But yeah, I think it's actually just about being with them, sharing kind of the office rituals, and they come and become part of that. So when we ship something, you know, they'll press the button that makes the dragon roar. They can share in the cake table and things like that. But it's just those office rituals that it sounds such a stupid thing to do, but it actually does work. They actually begin to think, hey, I'm part of this project. I'm part of this team. And actually, they really enjoy it. Cool.
A big round of applause for Rich, please.